yonk at the block screaming like an animal. Curse thumping, I crunch skulls like a animal. Make you disappear, new magic mom, man. Who killed Hannibal? Who killed Hannibal? Take his...
What up? The block.
Wait, hold up. Can you change the channel? Yeah, I think this was about to start.
This is Unholy Blessings, and you're listening to Eat Worms Radio.
Hello, everybody. Welcome to Eat Worms Radio. We have, of course, Kid Cuisine.
Hey, right yo.
Here in the flesh, we have Vincente.
What's good, everybody?
Ambient, right here. And myself, Beto, or Evan. And today we have our amazing guests. We have Ike and Pablo from the legendary duo, Unholy Blessings.
Yeah,
what's up? About, thank you so much for coming to this radio show.
Thank you for having us, man. That's just insane. Man, it's our first interview, like, ever.
That's crazy.
Yeah, we're not even a professional interviewer. We kind of just... One day we were just sitting in our room, like in my room, and we decided let's do something where we just play our own music and like talk about stuff. And then eventually at some point we're like, we should have guests and we should ask them questions too. It kind of just came together haphazardly, but yeah, it's becoming something cool. And
we're going to take it and have our own show.
It's not that original of an idea. It's not the first radio talk show.
Basically a radio talk. Yeah.
I mean, it's not totally unique. But, you know, as soon as I knew that I was going to do it like this, that we're going to be interviewing people, I knew I had to interview you guys because I've been following your guys' music for quite some time now. I don't even remember how long it's been.
First release, bro.
Yeah, like last year-ish. First release. Yeah. Why about then? Yeah, so I guess I'll go right into it. We're gonna do this first question.
Why don't we get them to tell us about like what they do, like a little bit of
yeah. What do you guys do? For those who don't know, what are Unholy Blessings?
Should I?
Oh, Bob, you wanna take it?
Yeah. Okay. So we're a duo. We basically make like hip hop ish. Like that's the general term, but like, I don't know, we make a whole bunch of shit, like, in many sounds, but we're trying to keep it more cohesive nowadays. And we make music over the internet, so we've never met in real life, but, you know, we use FaceTime and shit, and he sends me vocals, I send him beats, and, like, we just get this shit rolling over the airwaves, you know what I mean?
Right. So... Pablo is mainly producer, but I'm pretty sure you do vocals sometimes too, right?
Yeah, I'm slowly doing more like vocal shit, but Ike's the main lyricist, and you do all like the lyrical concepts and shit. Like you basically think of what to say. I just kind of do beats mostly.
Yeah. We kind of like complement each other. Like that's really what brought us together, because I started making music. I literally just like writing in my notes and stuff like that. And before Pablo, like I people probably know him. I don't know, like Lucas Lex, like I started making music with him. I dropped my first song with him. But like my whole career has really been like, you know, not knowing how to produce. And I've like always like relied on producers and stuff like that. Shout out Lucas Lex, by the way. Thank you.
Yeah, I was going to talk about that, actually. That's how I found you guys, was through him. I'm pretty sure he was adminning for, like, a Brockhampton fan page or something like that. Okay. And I think I ended up following him and listening to his music, and it was awesome. And somehow I got connected to you guys. And, then I listened to your music, and then I saw he was on there, too. And I'm like, oh, that's awesome. You guys have been frequent collaborators. Rain, bro.
Yeah, basically, like, this is how it all started, because... Like this was like back in like 2018. I was like we were
late
all
2018.
Like, yeah, we were all like really big Brockhampton fans, right? Like
of course.
The same way Brockhampton kind of came together through Kanye is kind of like how me, Pablo, Ben, and a whole bunch of other people came together through Brockhampton. Like I think I even met a freaking I don't know. I met so many people through Brockhampton, and I follow his page one day, and just like he made the on his story.
You want the I want Jabari shirt?
He posted on his story. What's it called? Like he needed like someone who wrote music or whatever, and I hit him up and I was like, yo, like I write, but like I never really made a song before. And then it just became me and Ben. We were this group called Season High, and as we progressed, we started like dropping music. We dropped this one song called Preacher, and like I don't know, like it did pretty well. Like it has like I think like almost 10K plays on SoundCloud right now. I don't know why. It's honestly not that good song, if I'm gonna be but yeah, just like that was like our very first song that we made together, and it was pretty crazy because it was just like it was just something that we just did over the phone. Same thing with me and Pablo. Like I recorded like, you know, without a mic or whatever on GarageBand. It was just like something super improvised, and we sampled Kanye. I Thought About Killing You, you know. So like it was a weird formula that we put together, but started making more music and stuff like that, and then we got a little bit of buzz, I guess you could say, like on Instagram. But Ben was already like kind of popping at the time. Like he was like, you know, doing his own thing before I even came around. But eventually Season High was like 10 deep. We had like 2 mans in the UK, 3 people in Florida. We had Pablo join and stuff like that. And it was a whole bunch of like stuff going on.
Yeah, I joined because I followed Ike because of the whole I Want Jabari shirt thing. And I think you messaged me or you posted on your story like looking for people to join, and I was like, yo, I produce shit.
Yeah, it was something like that. I'm pretty sure. Yeah, no, I DM you Pablo.
Posted on your. I'm pretty sure. No, I thought it was you posting on your story. I don't know.
Man, but, this is we do this a whole lot, man. You're gonna be remembering shit. Play life by ear.
Yeah, no, I totally get that. But, I mean, I met a lot of people over internet, and we don't even remember how we meet sometimes.
Yeah, basically.
Me and Pablo like just met off of that whole Season High thing, off of Jabari shirt, really. But like, he joined Season High, and
we made one song with them, and then shit was just kind of like fizzled out.
Yeah,
and then me and him were just like, "Fuck it, let's do this shit, you and me." And then that's when we started like the Unholy Blessings, but under the name Rager's Dream, because that was like, our first thing. Released a Dolomite. That was like November, December, right, Ike?
2018, bro. That was like November, December, 2018.
That's crazy.
Was like our first song, and like we made that song before we even like disbanded from Season High. Like me and Pablo were just like sitting here, like this was a really. After some rap songs dropped, and
I remember
like I was listening to December 24th, and I was like, bro, like I gotta write to this tempo, like this is such a good song, like this is like inspiring me to write to it. And just like at that time, me and Pablo were just like loving the album, bro. So we made it, like Dolomite was just basically like our rendition of December 24th, and just ever since then, like it's just history, bro.
Yeah, we just keep making shit, always making beats, always writing verses.
That's really cool. Yeah. It's really cool to hear the background and all of that. For those who don't know, the Jabari shirt was a weird trend. Like only on that fan page, Jabari, one of the members and producers of Brockhampton, and I don't even remember how it started exactly.
Bro, no, literally
on that page.
Literally, like the
and he responded to it.
Yeah, it was on. I think their name at the time was Merlin Hood. Not really sure what their name was at the time.
Oh yeah, Merlin Hood. Now it's Caden's Room, I think.
Don't even care no more, bro. Honestly, I fought them a long time ago. But like it was on Merlin Hood, and Jabari had like this shirt about Pitchfork getting a 6.5 or Pitchfork giving a saturation a 6.5.
Right.
And like my comment was so like grammatically like wrong. I said, I want Jabari's shirt. And the whole comment section was just repeating it like, bro, Like, are y'all making fun of me?
Yeah, it was half of like clowning you, and then also half of like
it's just shit posting.
It was funny.
Yeah.
Yeah, it's fucked.
But like, it was crazy because Kevin Dawn posted it. I think HK posted it.
Yeah.
And it was just like, bruh, like.
I'm pretty sure Jabari said something about it too.
Yeah.
Like, didn't y'all get a Jabari? Didn't he make they? Didn't they make a Jabari shirt for the ear?
I have the shirt still, bro. I still have the shirt.
That's good.
People have been trying to buy it off me. I'm like, no, like this shirt right here means a whole lot to me, bro.
Wait. So you have like a one of one shirt?
No.
But they just dropped something.
It was like an iridescent shirt, wasn't it?
Yeah.
It was kind of hard shirt though.
I still have that shirt. I cannot give up. Cause like it was like when that shirt dropped, what Ben did was like since I guess they thought that I was the one who came up with the shirt idea because I said I want Jabari shirt, and then they ended up making a Jabari shirt.
So it wasn't even about a shirt with Jabari on it. It was just the shirt he was wearing.
Exactly, and like
that's what it meant.
Yeah,
right. You just now got it.
Yeah, bro, you just now figuring out that's what it meant?
I didn't know.
2 years later.
Don't kill me.
Bro, Jabari shirt.
Know that's what it meant.
Yeah. But like Ben, like he like did like this PayPal donation thing, and he was like everybody.
Ben is Lucas Lex, by the way.
Right. I don't know who Ben is. Ben is somebody else. Like not Lucas Lex. But they did a thing for me, and like the whole fan page like bought the shirt for me. They like donated $1 each.
And it was an expensive shirt.
it was like $20-something. It wasn't.
Yeah, that's really cool. That's really cool. They gave back to the person who founded that.
I feel like I don't deserve it though, because I don't even follow them no more. Like, but yeah, I feel kind of guilty.
I mean, things change. Time goes on.
Yeah. Unholy Blessings started off of a Brockhampton meme. There you go.
Basically, bro.
That's great to hear. I mean, I've always been like hesitant to ever like feed into those things. And people are always just trying to like, oh, let's start another group. Let's start a Brockhampton sort of thing. But so many people don't follow through. And I mean, that's kind of seemed like what it was with Season High. It was like you guys
made
a couple of stuff and then you guys just stopped. But it's cool that you guys branched off and kept going. And when I heard Radio Dream, I was like, this is a cohesive album. And I know that you guys are going to keep doing more. And you guys did. And I'm really happy.
I hate Arsenal.
Because we're both motivated. You hate it?
I don't like my contribution to that album at all.
What? Really?
There's I like it, bro.
On that.
I'm God.
Classics. To that album.
I get you got some you got some missed verses like that could have been better, but like bro, Kia it was Soul. Our first record. Like we could have Kia Soul was hard, bro. That shit, like you killed that shit.
I know. I played
that's a lot of people's favorite song.
Really?
Yeah. I've had like three different people specifically tell me how much they like Kia Soul or they listen to it on Spotify. And like send it a screenshot. Nah, bro.
Yeah, Kia Soul. I think YTF Part 2 might be my favorite.
What?
Really?
That's exactly what I'm talking about, bro.
That's the weirdest cut off the album, bro. No, I really like that one.
The bass in that song be knocking, bro.
I always come back to that track. And I feel like Kia Soul is a more accessible track. When I want to play you guys or something, I'm like, all right, let's play something that it will like be stuck in their head. Like YTF is really heated and I love it. Like it's a really nice energy. And I think it really embodies what this album is about, really.
Yeah, man, y'all not.
We had two parts to them. Is that important?
Yeah, exactly. Why the fuck? You know that's what it's.
Yeah, that's what it stands for. Yeah.
Yeah.
I love that. I never even seen anybody do that before.
Yeah, that was cool. That was some shit. We were just like, I was just like, because there's this thing in Toronto called the GO Train, which is basically just like a metropolitan train that goes like across different like a few different cities, right? So you can travel from like. I don't know, the West End to the East End and shit like that. And then go into like the suburbs and whatever. But after school, I always got to take that. Or well, like not anymore because we graduated. But like at that time, I would take that train. And like me being this like 6 foot like Mexican dude dressed in like all black. I always got these. Like I would always take the rush hour train. Uh-huh. So it'd be just a bunch of like white business people staring at me. And I'd just be like. doing my own thing. But like, I don't know if like, it's just like, basically that's where like the whole sentence was like, what the fuck? You staring at me? And I was just like,
oh, okay.
It was like a simple thing, but like we kind of elaborated it on to just like, bro, like people just need to like mind their own business. No, and stuff. Yeah.
That song is still relevant today.
It'll forever be relevant.
On God.
Oh yeah.
Like, yeah. It's just like, I really like, I don't like going in public for a lot of reasons, but like one of the biggest reasons I don't like going out in public is because like these rich people just love staring at you, bro. Like
it's
like,
whack, bro.
Like my car isn't even as nice as yours, bro. Like look at yourself, bro. Like
on God.
Like
for real.
I'm just like an everyday dude, right? I'm just coming in the store buying me a burger, right?
Right.
What?
And these niggas keep on looking at me. Like I don't understand. Like, what are you looking at? Like, have you never seen a black person before? Have you never seen someone wear a Black Lives Matter shirt before? I don't understand. What's so baffling about a black person?
On God.
That's crazy. You're at the burger place.
You have to be open-minded there. At a fast food restaurant where
I don't know why their standards are so high. It's a damn fast food restaurant.
That's exactly, bro. Like, it's just, it's annoying, bro. But
it's just people got this like subconscious shit in their mind that they can't help but stare when like they see like an anomaly or something that like is not necessarily abnormal, but is not something that they see often or are accustomed to seeing, and it's just kind of like very subtle, like xenophobia.
Yeah.
It's just like,
yeah, basically,
it's whatever. Or they just make judgments and like they stare at you to like keep an eye on you to make sure you're not gonna do some shit. But it's like, bruh, I'm minding my own business. You mind your own business. But yeah. Anyway, yeah, that's just
I'm kind of tripping up on this question about it, but like, how deep is like the Mexican population in Canada? Because I never thought about that. I mean, like, I'm Mexican. Vincent's Mexican. There's plenty of Mexican people in California. But yeah. I mean, how deep is it from Canada?
It's a lot. It's like I can't really talk much about the Mexican population specifically, but there's like a Latino population.
Because it's like easier to immigrate that way, right?
Yeah, like, especially like because I have like my family has a lot of like family friends from like Mexico or the north of Mexico, or like Latino friends that they just met because when they immigrated here, like. They just kind of gravitated together through, I don't know, different means.
Right, you gotta sit together.
But, yeah. Like, it's in the early 2000s, it was just way easier to immigrate here.
More recent.
Yeah, my parents arrived here in 2000, and then I was born 2 years later, right? So my sister was already, like, was born back in Mexico, but... But like it's not like the predominant, like I wouldn't say not predominant, but it's like there's like the majority is like white people because it's Canada, right? And then like but the most like predominant like ethnic population or just like non-white population is probably like people from like East Asia or Caribbean people or people from immigrants from Africa. Right. There's a lot of presence in that, especially in the culture. That's why there's like a lot of the Toronto slang is derivative of like dialects and like slang from the Caribbean. And because people are like, oh, like Toronto's just copying Britain's, but it's like, nah, both of you get it from the Caribbean. But when it comes to the Latino population, it's not like the most present, but like they're here. We're here. You know what I mean?
So. Oh yeah, that's cool. I knew that Canada was kind of more of a safe space for migration, but I never thought about like Mexican people going over. Like, I mean, my family migrated like the 70s. I mean, I think, I mean, it's still happening now. It's just as closer or whatever. But I mean, I had friends that I met that were from the Philippines, and one of my close friends, he was born in the Philippines, but he grew up most of his life in Canada. And then eventually they were able to get American citizenship and they came here. But they just started there. That was the easier way to get there.
Yeah, exactly. Like, it's like Canada, I wouldn't go as far say it's a safe space because there's still, like, if you go outside of the big cities, there is a lot of, like, anti-immigrant sentiments or anti-Islamic and, like, semi-racist, not semi-racist, like, but, like, pretty, like, racist shit going on in the small towns, you know, like, middle of bumfuck nowhere, you know what I mean?
Yeah.
Like, cottage country type shit. That's but, it's, yeah, basically. It's just, but when it comes to comparing it to, like, U.S. cities, it is a lot more welcoming that relative to that. Like, it's
yeah,
it's not, there's not as much of a stigma being an immigrant that it like, it still follows you everywhere you go. And for example, like, my parents, they were like, you know, they have degrees, and like, my mom was a teacher, like, studied that and went to law school, so she was also a lawyer. But like, there's just like stuff in the system that basically puts like new immigrants down onto a level right, where they can't use that shit, right? Like, it's like, it's just, it seems like it's a technicality, like, oh, your degree from Mexico doesn't work here, but it's,
yeah,
like,
it's like a handicap.
That shit's arbitrary as fuck, you know what I mean?
Yeah.
It's just like, basically you're gonna start at a factory level job or like some like entry level shit so that you don't take jobs away from like white people. But like, it still exists, and there's still like systemic oppression in the Canadian government, especially against Indigenous people, because like, bruh, the history with that in Canada's fucked up.
No, I mean, it's the same thing here. I mean, Canada and America have a lot in common of just the history of how they're founded and what the ethnic population is. And I think the stigma for immigration, I mean, I can't say for Canada, but from what you're saying, it sounds exactly the same how it is here.
It is the same. It's just, we have a smaller population, so people think it doesn't exist as much, but it's a very present. It just also kind of manifests itself in different ways, because people aren't like, it's very few people that like are overtly racist. Like in the US, someone will like someone will call like Ike the N-word, or like say some shit, no, or call like,
people,
you know,
are very proud to be racist here.
Yeah, exactly. But like, over here, it's more like there is a stigma. There's a very clear stigma against being racist, because Canada's just slightly more like left-leaning, but people still have their like subconscious prejudices, and like a lot, like everybody like is still like, they don't actually take action to like help Indigenous communities or any shit like that. Like, it exists, and it's more subtle, and it's kind of more like all like the microaggression type shit rather than like, mm-hmm, literally calling somebody a slur or telling them that they should like leave and go back to their country. Like, obviously that shit happens. Like, you see it on like Six Buzz, which is like the World Star of Toronto. But it just manifests itself in different ways. It's not necessarily non-existent.
Yeah.
Yeah, that's just a tangent.
That's interesting to hear. I never heard that. I mean, I don't know anybody in Canada, so it's really interesting to hear that kind of stuff, because I feel like a lot of those things, like just, you know, systemic oppression and just like those microaggressions, those things, mm-hmm, don't ever reach media. Those aren't things people talk about. I mean, I can definitely get how people are hearing about it now in America because, mm-hmm, of like all the protests
social
happening.
Media, not just but, that. So
yeah, no, social media is viral here.
Exposes it a lot.
Yeah, it skyrockets. But I mean, yeah, I mean, it's kind of saddening to hear that's how it is like everywhere. Like, there's,
yeah,
some people think like, oh, it's better to go to Canada, it's better to go to UK, and I'm like, I'm pretty sure it's the same thing. If you hear about their situation, it's the same problems they have to deal with.
Yeah, literally. It's just really the US is more blatant about it. That's the thing.
Yeah,
that's
we just got a bunch of balls, I guess, because people really feel privileged to have the rights they have, and
The thing with the US, it's more in power here, bro. You got a whole racist president. This man is making bills.
On God,
this man's making bills against us for tearing down a dead image called Confederacy. But this man won't at least indict fucking Breonna Taylor's killers. Like, mm-hmm, prove me if I'm wrong. But at least, like, still Elijah's murderers are still out here walking free.
Yeah, and the thing is, it's worse is that a lot of the murders people bring up now happened months before the protest.
A whole year ago.
Some of them are years old.
Elijah died last year, bro. Last year.
Exactly. Oh yeah, exactly.
And these people are still on payroll, getting paid. People are paid to shoot us, bro. People are paid to
beat us. At most, their punishment is like a paid vacation. Like, they literally get paid leave or like suspended with pay. You know what I mean? It's like, it's just, they just keep perpetuating this shit. And obviously having a racist president does not, like, and people get so turned up when you call him racist, but it's like, bro, that's what he is. Even if he doesn't overtly say he hates people from a certain race, which sometimes he implies it.
Retweeting
a white power video, just like boom.
If you're not gonna immediately condemn the KKK, then what the fuck does that say? You know
exactly.
What I mean?
Exactly. Your pops walked around with a cone on his head. You stupid dumbass. Of course you're gonna be racist.
Yeah. And it's just like at least our prime minister was like, and he was smart. Like, I gotta give him credit. Like, he's not perfect. He's done some, like, he's iffy. Like,
who, Justin Obama? Trudeau.
No, Justin Trudeau. Minister. I'm talking about Prime Minister. Nah, he's white as a motherfucker.
Hey, man, we know about Obama now.
I'm God. But, he's not perfect. But, like, what I do commend him, or, like, what I would give him credit for is, like, the way he was smart about the way he had to like address that shit. And he was like, systemic racism like does exist in Canada. Like the fact that he acknowledges it.
Yeah, we don't have anything like that here.
First step. Yeah, like nobody wants to acknowledge that shit exists.
And he targets protesters and says they're the ones causing the problem.
And people look at me crazy when I say I want to go move to Canada. The mess. Like
better free health. Like sure, we pay more taxes. Like you get a nice chunk cut out of your check. But like that shit feeds into shit that supports the people and people who need like healthcare, social
services. And that's the balance. That's the balance like America needs, bro. Like people don't understand that like if we take more away from the rich, then that's just going to create more balance between the rich and the poor. Like, there's such a divide.
It's like the people who want to keep that shit in interest are just, they have an interest in keeping the money up there. So they're not going to, like, the government's not going to implement that shit because they got these huge companies lobbying.
Yeah.
They're so stupid, though, because, like, that's not good for the economy.
It's not.
To hold money up. It's not. The way the economy works, you got to circulate the money.
Down. Exactly. Yeah. But it's like they're all about that trickle-down economics. It's like, okay, we'll get down. Like a tiny little shit of like the billions that you're getting. But it's like you don't actually need those billions or millions to your business going. Like a lot of this shit, like you can have a profit with your company, but if you're just gonna keep if you want to keep increasing the profit to like insane levels, which is what you're incentivized to do because you want people investing in that shit, like especially for shareholders, they want their shares to go up in value. But like you don't need to keep making as much of a profit because people value like the profit over like, you know, the good of your workers, the good of the environment. Like it's like needs to be kind of like a regulation on the market. And even though like obviously the whole like foundation of like capitalism is free market.
Yeah.
And it's just like it's something that it's hard to get to control because these companies are already hyperinflated that they can influence the government. So
to be fair, we don't have an exactly capitalist economy. We have a mixed economy. And I think people kind of forget about that sometimes. Like, oh, you can't do this. Like, we have to be completely free. Like, if you're completely free, you would have children working as slaves in your factory.
We're not
completely free. And I feel like people still, like, don't consider the sacrifices they can make and how little of an impact they will have. Like, if you have billions of dollars, you can give up a little bit more to help the environment, to pay your workers a little bit more. Like, it's not
you should
buy for wages of thousands of people, but you act like you don't.
Niggas want to cash out on impossible meat and GMOs and shit. Like, bruh.
What?
I'm saying is, bro, people are investing into the wrong stuff. Like,
I can see that. Yeah.
Like, GameStop is guilty of this too. I stopped going to GameStop. I don't go to GameStop no more. Why do I gotta go there, give them some of the most beloved games ever that has more value than anything coming out today? I can go over there, give them Pokemon Sun and Moon, right? Oh yeah, that'll be $4. I can go to some random game and they'll probably pay me $60 in cash for them shits, right? Like, I don't understand why, like, people are, like, allowed to do shit like that. Like, people, like people are just, like, people just making profits just off of just anything that exploits anybody, bro. And I don't like that at
it's
all.
Like, y'all, yeah, I just think, like, the baseline of what they should be doing is paying their workers fair wages, because at least here in Canada, we have a pretty good minimum wage. Like, I think, like, $13-$14 an hour, depending on, like, your job.
Yeah, it varies.
And that's, it's obviously more in CAD, but, like, that's, like, I don't know, I think that's, like, 10-ish bucks per hour in USD. So it's, like, that's pretty good, but, like, in some states, like, the minimum wage is, like, obscenely low. And I was just, like, it's, like, I understand that small businesses have to kind of pay their workers less, but instead of that, it's, like, it should, you should incent, like, huge companies should be, like, are able to pay their workers way more, and they should, but they don't.
But that's the thing. Small businesses gotta pay their people less because bigger businesses already have all
the
money.
They don't have an option.
They don't make
exactly.
They don't have an
option. Like, it makes sense in that, like societal, like, turnaround, yeah, in that just you need to, like,
we need a cultural reset.
Yeah, like, low key and a high key. You just need to, like, support local shit because we're all, like, we're used to be, like, being
support
in such a globalized
business.
Exactly. Like, we're being used to being in such a globalized society that, like, international companies and shit, like, we buy from them. And some shit, it makes sense to buy from big companies. Like, technology isn't, like on a mass, like, on, like shit like iPhones and computers. It's, like, that's harder to do on a local business level. But if you're going to buy groceries, books, like, anything you need, instead of buying that shit from Amazon, buy it from a store that's near you. You know what I mean? Like, instead of getting, like, sure,
it's changing.
It's convenient to get it from Amazon. It's yeah, people are, like, slowly,
like,
realizing
right now,
that shit. But,
like, right now, we're kind of forced to that point because, I mean, a lot of our goods we get produced are in China, and there's all these different things preventing us from getting our goods delivered from China and produced in China. Mm-hmm. I mean, if we look at our country, not even, like, 50 years ago, almost every manufactured item was made in America. And as we found out that, oh, we can get paid less in China, we started moving our factories in China. But now that we're closed off from the world and we're kind of forced to do this here, people have been starting to turn to more local businesses and mm-hmm. have no other options because all the stuff they want is made in China and they can't get it anymore. And now they're all mad mm-hmm. about it. And so I feel like now companies are going to have no choice but to start building factories in America because who knows how long it's going to keep this way. It could get worse. It could get better. We don't know.
Yeah,
but
I
think
mean,
the business choice would be better to bring it to America. We have all these people unemployed. Give them a job. Make them here.
Yeah, like it's the. I don't even know the extent of all different dynamics between China and the U.S. I can't even, like, fully speak on that.
Yeah,
I don't
know all that. Yeah.
But
it's as simple as this.
People, you just got to, like, if you have some wealth, if you have some money, like, support your people, bro. Like, support people you know. Support, like, either your community. Like, if you want to see your community shine and grow, do that. Like, instead of, I don't know, I've just, like, I've made a, like, a personal commitment to, like, try to not eat, like, fast food as much as possible. It's also partially a health thing, but it's, like, I was so, like, I love McDonald's, bro. I can't even lie. Like, a fucking burger from there is so good, but, like, I don't want to support
McDonald's.
A company like that, which also profits off of, like, prison labor and shit, you know what I mean? So it's like, start eating at the restaurant, like, that's, and it might be slightly more expensive, sure, but I think it's better for the community in the long run to do that, especially if the businesses also have a vested interest in their community. Like, if their main interest is to, like, keep expanding and build more shit, then, like, that's not really the goal. I feel like it's, like, make the people who live around you and support you also, you know, because if you're spending money there, then they can hire more people and they can.
I think that we should try to steer this a different way real quick.
Yeah, I was going to say.
Yeah, like, we're probably going to cut some of the stuff we've talked about. I mean, it's all really important stuff and I want to keep it on here as much as I can.
Definitely.
We do want to keep this thing short as we can, and also try to keep a variety of information. So
definitely.
I think it's a good time to move into a song. We'll save your song for last. It's going to be exciting.
So,
Vincent or Gage, do you want to play a song or should I play my song?
I mean, I can go, I guess.
It's whichever one of you want to do it.
I already have the link up. I'll just play mine, I guess.
Yeah, that's good.
This song, I don't even know how I found it, but when I found it, I couldn't stop listening to it. This is a Janet Jackson cut from Velvet Rope. Featuring Q-Tip and Joni Mitchell, a Canadian singer.
Yeah, I know Joni Mitchell.
Shout out Canada. All right. I love this song.
Shout out Q-Tip though.
RIP Five Dog.
I like this song.
I heard this song. Mr. Sandoval was playing it, and he was in the DJ and during like their DJ Fridays thing. And I recorded it on my phone, and it was like this video of Ricky messing with like the strobe light, and he was like in front of it, standing in it. And in the background is that song, and I was like forever, like I was like, what is that sample? So, thank you, Evan.
Yeah, I feel like I played it before.
I don't remember if you did.
But
yeah.
Vibe.
Yep. I'm eating ice. Not eating. Don't eat ice, but I'm eating ice.
I did, dude. I eat ice. That's just good, bro.
Alright, next question. How do you guys feel about eating ice?
Eating ice?
It's crunchy.
I'm pretty sure it's bad though. For your
it's
teeth.
Refreshing. My dog does that a lot. Sometimes the ice comes from the ice maker. From? Oh, like yeah. You know like the ice dispensers in the fridge?
Yeah.
Sometimes like one like falls on the floor or something like that, and he just kind of goes for it. I think his teeth are strong.
Good
though.
Taste.
Yeah, exactly.
Bro, one time, one of my mom's retarded friends told my mom not to feed my dog ice because it was bad for them and it would break their teeth. Like, bro, it's just water, and you can break that. Dogs literally have teeth designed to like chew on bones and stuff. Like,
bro, what is the ice gonna do? Kill you biting your neck.
Yeah. The dog has like the strongest teeth.
You know what? Ice is kind of like chocolate, you know? It just has stuff in that you can't eat.
So many things. Like, they can't have chocolate. They can't have grapes. They can't have avocados.
They can't have grapes?
No.
Oh, shit. No.
You can't have a chocolate. I don't know if you said that. I was blanking out.
Yeah, I said that one.
Yeah.
I can't remember. They just die from everything. How did that happen? Anyway. Don't want to get
I got a theory about that, bro. Y'all, I think y'all need to hear this, bro. All
right, let's hear it.
Dogs are the last carnivores alive. Hear me out.
Oh, okay.
What?
They can eat anything that has protein inside of it.
Uh-huh.
Only protein.
But like all vegetables have protein. They're just like
vegetables are just derivatives of meat because they have protein in it.
Plants came first.
When you put an egg, when you put an egg.
Okay.
Yeah, when you put an egg.
Yeah, when you put an egg.
It's gonna be some random vegetable that's gonna pop up and it has protein inside of it. Dogs can only eat things that derive from eggs. Uh-huh. Illuminati, Matrix. Stay woke.
Yeah, I don't even know what you're on.
Dude, like,
he's over here.
He's on another level, dude.
I need to listen to me. Like the bro, end times are coming.
He's speaking on the third, like the fourth dimension right now.
Not even, dude. Like, this is like my mind has its own third eye. Like, you see the third eye through my forehead, and then it's like my brain got a third eye. Like, you know, like on like the
you got boat. Four eyes.
So yeah, I got like four eyes.
But how's the eye in your brain see if it's on your brain behind your skull?
It's like
see on a physical level.
No. It's not physical. It's not the physical third eye.
It's seeing spirits and spectral level stuff. So basically,
your fourth eye is blind.
Nah.
No, but it sees so much more.
My fourth eye is connected to the universe.
So you got a portal in your skull.
We are all one.
Yeah.
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 We're living in
don't eat anything if it doesn't come out of an egg, am I right?
Oh god.
What came first, the vegetable or the egg? That's a really important question.
Vegetable. Anyway.
I got a question for y'all.
Okay.
And I have it's only one right answer.
Okay.
It's all only right.
Don't say some right stupid shit, bro.
It's the egg, bro. I know it. That's my final answer.
Look.
Take it or leave it.
Why do you think your girlfriend broke up with you yesterday?
Because the egg came first.
Because Eve bit the apple first.
What?
And then came lust. No, I'm just playing. Snake is a dude.
I would just...
Men have always been... I feel like Adam low-key wanted to bite the apple first. He low-key just... I feel like he told Eve to go bite the apple, bro. I feel like the Bible don't tell you that.
Like,
the Bible don't tell you
double that. Dog dared her.
I would just like to say.
I just think the Bible is like.
I feel like Adam told Eve, "Yo, go bite that apple," and Eve was really like, "Nah," and Adam was like, "That did look good, don't it?" And Eve was like, "Yeah, that did look kind of good." So Eve went up to the apple and was like, "Yo, I low-key don't want to bite this apple, but Adam told me to. I need like someone to curve my opinion real quick." And then the snake came in and was like, "Yo, Adam's right, bite the apple." The Bible don't tell you that, but my fourth eye do.
The unabridged version of the Bible.
Okay.
Unabridged Genesis.
Adam was like, "I'll give you $1 if you bite that apple, that good behind apple."
Well, I thought
I'll give you a dollar
because of the apple.
I'll give you the
dollars
seashell, bro.
Back then.
I'll give you the seashell.
Right, that's what dollars
bro, I'll
worth.
Give you
sand
this,
dollars, duh.
I'll give you this leaf, bro. I'll give you this
Yo,
leaf.
Yo, did $10 come before dollars?
Nah.
Yeah, why
bro, that's where the dollar came from.
What came first, the chicken or the egg? For real.
The vegetable.
It was the vegetable, bro.
It was like a proto chicken.
You're right.
A proto chicken birthed the egg of the chicken.
But nah, yeah, like what
proto
if,
chickens.
But nah, like what
evolution,
if,
like, sir?
Curious George.
You know what? You know what? The egg
fish
did.
Tank.
The egg did come before the chicken. Cause hear me out. Chickens, right? Birds. They're descendants of dinosaurs, and dinosaurs laid eggs. So technically, one day a dinosaur laid an egg.
That's what I said. I said there was a proto chicken that laid the first chicken.
The proto chicken
was.
I don't know how the chicken was a step up beyond dinosaur, but
it just is, bro.
It just happens.
So then that must mean that cavemen were crossbreeding this whole entire time. Where do you think all these animals came from?
They're just making them.
Exactly.
There had to be like a Joe Exotic of the caveman time, bro. His name was like Kunji Exotic or some bullshit like that.
You guys want to play another song?
Yeah,
play another song.
All right, Vincent. What do you got?
I could go. It's your boy always bringing that indie kind of music. This is by an artist called Blankets without the E. Mm. And she's actually from Canada as well. And I think she's Latina. I don't know. I don't know what ethnicity she is.
Canadians made music.
Yeah, no, I was surprised too. I was like, I didn't know anything came
can
out of
this country. Can we just call this the Canadian edition?
Yeah, so I've been following them ever since I heard them on Soda Island, which is a music collective, and I don't know, their stuff is really nice, but this song is called Shoes. It's released about a year ago, I think, so hold on a sec, we play it. Yo, shout out to Blankets, dude. I'm sorry if you ever somehow watch this, I'm sorry if I got your ethnicity wrong. Yo, she sent me a letter, though. All the way from fucking Canada.
Bruh.
Pretty far.
Yeah. I didn't even know that place existed.
I didn't even know they had a postal system, bro.
They probably carried it on horseback.
Yeah.
It's okay, we can call in Canada.
Canada Post is pretty fire, in my opinion.
They launch it out in like a rocket, and then
is it like the Pony Express? Do they still do that? It's like a whole bunch of people on horses, and they just relay it to one another.
Bro, that's sick. We should bring that back. Like road robbers, you know, like highwaymen.
Someone comes in, like,
why don't we have letters now with the postal service? Like, people just pull up next to a post off, like a post worker, and rob them. Like,
they rob the FedEx. That's why the doors open on the side of the FedEx vans. It's so
they have like a turret in there.
No, it's so if they did get robbed, it could just easily be done, and then, you know, there's no trouble involved.
Oh, okay.
To make the highway they have easier. Doors on there to make them.
Is that for real?
For the robbers. Yeah, no, the post office trucks, they don't have doors.
Why?
Here for some reason. I don't know. So they can jump out easier if they get them.
No, I seen like the UPS trucks come up here, and like the driver's door is just non-existent. I don't get why.
Yeah.
It makes it more
I don't know.
Maybe they just so they can
they
get
got,
out.
They
fast.
Don't have AC in there.
It's so if they
turn around and shoot from the side of the vehicle, you know?
Yeah. it's for easy rollout access in case they ever like hit a ramp and get too much air.
Get rid of the goods.
And then bail out.
Yeah.
You can bail out.
I can just imagine them like bailing out and then rolling, and then like they drive the truck off the bridge and then it explodes as they are facing away from it.
Exactly.
Shout out to postal workers.
Shout out postal workers.
Essential. Dude. You're the real heroes.
Essential.
I remember.
Workers.
They are.
Dude, they got all my parts here. I mean, like, shit, dude. They're doing their job well. Thank you.
Sometimes y'all be slipping up.
Except for that one idiot who delivered that package to the wrong address, and it was like this guy across the street with the same house address as me. It's not the same street, though, okay? You gotta read a little bit further.
One time, an Uber driver sent the food, our food, like it was like $100 worth of food.
Wow.
Because we were having like a big dinner, and he sent it to he delivered it at 7810, like, because it's like a townhouse complex, so it's kind of weird, but he sent it to 78 on the other side of the street, like the complete different side that you have to walk into the complex. So we had to like go and find our food, but eventually we got our money back, so we just got like $100 worth of free food. It was blessed.
Oh, wow. Shout out Uber.
Shout out Uber. Lose our food more often.
Yeah.
Mm-hmm.
My accidental.
I'm going to hide it up my ass.
Sir, I can't find my food. Can I get a refund?
Why is there Coca-Cola leaking out of your pants?
I can't find it. You owe
me. I can't find
drink.
It.
I can't I have can't my th- food without my drink.
And you just like squat down over the pizza.
I'm so confused.
This actually happened to me before, though. So,
oh,
what?
I'm just
put Coca Cola up your butt.
Nah, it was Mellow Yellow.
Mellow Yellow.
All right. I think it's time for Gage's song.
Okay. So,
we're shooting back to back. Let's go.
If it's not quite as black.
Back to back. Speed hour.
Okay, so.
Back in black. I hate this.
So, you know, I'm on my ghost.
It better be from Canada.
No. Mm, no, it's from Japanada.
Ooh.
Okay, that's close enough.
And so,
ooh.
Yeah, so you know I'm on my Ghost in the Shell kick, and I was watching Ghost in the Shell Arise like last week, and you know, I'm listening, and this is another one of those cases where I was listening and a soundtrack to something like surprised me. So basically he just did the whole soundtrack for this like 5-part OVA. He made the intro to it. I thought it was kind of fire, and even though it only plays for like a minute in the show, it's really like 3 minutes long. And so, yeah, right, here so it is.
Listening to an anime intro. Got it.
Yeah, yeah, but it's not like Issei no Sei. Not like that kind of, yeah, here you go. Z-Worms Radio, and you're listening to Cornelius.
Hot. I like that.
That was really great.
I don't want to be horny anymore.
Cornelius delivered.
That song like, reminded me why I like trippy. Sleep Paralysis so much.
Why you don't like or you do?
Why I do like it.
Oh, for real? You be inducing sleep paralysis?
Dang, he be having robot sex.
Hey man, don't worry about me, bro. Don't worry about me.
Robot sex is the way of the future. You already know.
I play Mass Effect. Y'all don't. I'm just built different.
Yo.
Perfect. Hey man. Hey man.
What video games do you guys play?
I've recently been playing like Minecraft an obscene amount because of the update, the Nether update.
Oh yeah.
But on my PS4, I've been playing God of War.
Y'all don't want to hear my answer, bro. The list is too fucking long.
Yeah, bro. Ike's like a video game god, man.
Recently I've been doing like runs in like multiple games. Like I just beat the Archaeologist in Minecraft Dungeons a few days ago. About to start the new difficulty or whatever. While doing that, I'm also doing a run in Witcher 3. Blood and Broken Bones. The game's kind of hard on that difficulty. While also playing Dark Souls Remastered, and I just ordered Dark Souls 3. So,
oh,
yeah,
How is Minecraft Dungeons?
Minecraft Dungeons is lit. That's all I gotta say, bro. That game.
If you like Diablo, amazing. You like Minecraft Dungeons.
Yeah, basically.
All right, yeah. Because I was hearing it's kind of easy.
No,
I don't know.
Yes, it is easy, very easy. But like, you gotta like make the game hard. Like, you gotta like, put yourself in positions to make the game hard.
Yeah, because there are like different levels you can do the levels. Like, there are different difficulties you can do the levels. Different right, from what I know,
to make it hard. Yeah. I get it. I see
what there's different ways to
people who say the game is easy clearly didn't play like past like you know easy mode, right? Like, of course, game's gonna be easy. They need to bring back stylistic video game box art because I'm tired of looking at the same boring character on Assassin's Creed all the time.
The same,
it's the same dude every single time. I don't care.
I mean, but Assassin's Creed isn't that EA, right?
No, that's Ubisoft.
Ubisoft.
Oh, Ubisoft. Okay, Ubisoft, EA. They're both.
Yeah, they're the same. Yeah. They're really the same. Like,
yeah. Ubisoft.
I don't know. I don't know what you expect from Ubisoft. Guys,
like,
yeah.
Triple A developers are all kind of like in the same boat.
Yeah. Whoa. Not all of them. We can't rope all AAA developers.
I wasn't saying all, but I'm just like. It's like people like Ubisoft and Activision and EA are all kind of like similar.
Yeah, they all have the same business
model. Yeah,
they
don't give a shit about the cover.
And it's just like you're just
I like companies like Naughty Dog, bro.
Dude, Naughty Dog is releasing the best shit. Dude.
Honest,
I'm telling you, The Last of Us 2. If you guys see the reviews and you see people saying it's shit. Oh. Bro, if you see people saying it's shit, try it out. Try it out.
The reviews are total mess, bro. Like, the game isn't that bad.
It's not that bad.
Don't talk about it, because I have not played it yet. I haven't played the first one. Like, I know the first one.
Oh, my God.
When I was, like, 12, I watched... Or not 12. I don't know when the game came out. I watched the Let's Plays, because I didn't have a PS4 at that time. That shit was dumb.
No, dude, same. That's what
so, like, that's I know I this. Like, that's why I love The Last of Us, because I just like I followed the story and the gameplay was really cool. But like, I want to actually play on my PS4 that I have now, and then play The Last of Us 2 like sequentially. But first, I have to
finish God of War. They got a remastered version.
Yeah, exactly.
The remastered looks so good.
PS4, so that's what I'm gonna.
Working
on.
The reviews. Don't listen to the reviews, but just. Don't listen to the reviews, bro. I mean, what you're...
Yeah, dude, fuck the reviews. People are, like basing it off the leaks. They're like, oh, this game's shit. Dude, try it out for yourself.
Just form your own opinion about it.
And then, exactly. Form your own opinion. If you hear someone saying a certain burger is shit, you don't be like, oh, yeah, that burger is shit. You go and try it and be like, yeah, that burger was pretty good.
It just sucks because people literally bought the game... To shit on it, you know,
and then like refunded it too. Yeah, they're like before the pre-order, they're like refunding it because of the leaks. That shit's devastating,
like,
man.
I'm not gonna like buy this game, and then they end up buying it anyways, and they still complain about it. Like, what's up with the gaming community nowadays, bro? They complain about literally everything, bro. Like today,
bro.
Yeah.
I was on Instagram, and literally, I was on this fan page, and it was like. It was like Marvel's Avengers. Is it connected to Spider-Man PS4? Like, duh. Like, it's made like Spider-Man PS4 is made by Insomniac, and Activision's making freaking Avengers. Of course, they're not gonna be the same freaking thing. Why would it be?
Two different developers and two different games.
Two different storylines, bro. Yeah. It's not even in the same continuity. People are still complaining about that. It makes absolutely no sense.
Bro, gamers are just getting too spoiled here.
Oh. Mm-mm.
I mean,
bunch of nerds.
No,
nerds. I don't know, bro. I feel like I'm kind of scared for the drop of like Cyberpunk 2077 or something like that. Because
I've been waiting for that.
That game looks so good, but I feel like people are just gonna find something to complain about with that game, bro. Like,
they're gonna leak that shit and then shit on the game,
bro.
Dude, I'd still buy it if it.
Oh, leaked. For real? That's what I did with Borderlands 3.
I'm so into like the cyberpunk aesthetic. It's like my favorite thing ever. It's my favorite aesthetic.
Ooh, same, bro. Same.
So, like BioShock Infinite type. Cool.
No, that's steampunk.
Yeah, that's more steampunk.
Yeah, like
cyberpunk.
Cyberpunk's different, dumbass.
Cyberpunk's like Blade Runner. Blade Runner.
Yeah.
Yeah.
That's like the prime example.
Ghost in the Shell.
Akira.
Akira. Yeah. Akira.
Cyberpunk is basically like my big bin full of like scrap metal parts, electronics that I don't use.
Yeah, and steampunk is like
rusty
old technology.
It's like your dad's wrench. That's all rusted.
Your dad's box of
and
old
like
shit.
Some goggles and then like a steam engine, but it's all in like the Victorian era that. Clothing.
Yeah,
infamous
jetpack. Yeah, so I just want to ask, since like this is kind of happening so nonchalantly, but like, what are y'all like? Are y'all following like the whole like West Day ever? Like Kanye just like casually
blood
like,
in the water
doing all this shit, like the cartoons and you like the foam runner
with your blood.
Straight up just like Dr. Dre and him collabing, like that shit's insane, but I feel like it's not like people are talking about it as much.
He just announced Wash Us in the Blood is coming tomorrow, and it's on sale on his website right now too. Cassettes, CDs.
There you
go. Wait, what?
Bro, that's what I literally told you. Kanye
what?
Just
are you serious?
Casually just dropping.
It's a whole album?
It right now.
It's an album?
Wash Us in the Blood is a single, I think.
Wash Us in the Blood is a single, but there's supposed to be an album. It's Jesus is King 2.
Called God's version. Country, that with made with Dr. Dre. Yeah. Right? Yeah. So, bro, have you not been following it? That's
no.
What I'm talking about.
I just downloaded Instagram like 30 minutes ago, bro.
That's what I was telling you, man.
You can download the
Not just the Gap
picture disc right now.
I need that gap, though, bro. I need that gap, like, before anything. I need
That's
that
coming
gap.
2021. Like, low-key, we'll see how it looks like.
I got time to say.
We saw Pharrell with the blue hoodie. That's it.
Yeah.
Just a plain blue hoodie. There it is. There's your Yeezy.
Need that gap.
Hey, bro. Hey, I find I like closing with simplicity. Like, I know a bunch of streetwear shit like they put a bunch of graphics on their shit, but it's like just I don't know, I find I kind of like
fast fashion. It's fast food.
Yeah,
I like
that. If you come up with like, a good design that's simple, it works better than something claustrophobic.
Exactly.
I like the obscure stuff that doesn't have a logo on it.
That's what I've like learned more recently about music too. Like it's I think like because all of our older shit is a lot more like it's at least on the behalf of like my production is a lot more like complex and just like trying to fit a bunch of shit into like one thing, and I've learned to just kind of like leave space, because I think I like space is such an important thing in like music, because you like if not you're gonna feel like it's claustrophobic and the feeling that you're trying to give off is gonna get like distorted because there's so much going on that you can't actually like connect with it that well. So,
I mean,
like, the more space there is, like, it's not that like complicated shit just like isn't listenable, but it's just like when it comes to like you need to be there needs to be a point to the shit you're doing if there is complexity, and like obviously don't like make the most dumbed down shit because then it's not interesting. Like you still need to have like interesting sonics and like cool production lyrics and all that, but it's like if you there needs to be, I feel like if you're able to make something engaging out of something simple, then I think that's way harder and you've done a better job than if you're making something engaging out of something very complex, because something very complex is going to engage your brain. But if you can make something equally as like captivating and like connecting with the listener, that's like simple and like straight to the point, I think there's just kind of like a beauty in that. Most of the time when people are just like looping shit, I don't really like, it's like you got to create like a song, like it's got to move around, like add like, and like there still needs to be space, but you need to like direct the artist, or if the artist is yourself vocally or another person, you have to kind of like put things into the beat that direct the artist as to what to do in certain parts and how certain parts are supposed to interact with others, like the structure of it, if that makes sense. Like I'm talking about hella abstract shit, but like little fills or like cutouts and like slight rhythm changes in the drums or shit like that. That'll basically like cue the artist's ear if they like know what you're doing, if they understand like your production style. Like if they hear something, they'll be like, ah, I can switch it up here, or like I'll kind of do this. I don't know. I don't know if I'm making sense right now.
You're making perfect sense, bro.
Yeah,
you gotta, it's like if you have, we'll do video games because we all play video games. Mm-hmm. If you have like the player is like the vocalist or the artist who's working on your song, mm-hmm. you're like the guy building the level that the player is going to go through.
Exactly.
And like work with. And you got to kind of direct the player, hey, you're supposed to go here and focus on this. Mm-hmm. And like, don't really focus on this. This doesn't need that much attention. But like this, yeah. This is where you should put your effort. This is where you should be running away from the enemy or something. You know, you kind of got to like give stage direction to kind of push the artist to merge with the song.
Yeah, or like you can obviously give direction to the artist and be like, yo, I think you should do this here because, you know, as an ear, as a producer, you have an ear for like little things that can like make the song pop or little things that are making the song non-cohesive or it's like too much or too little. But like, you don't want to tell them, I want you to do this, 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 and this, because then they're not playing around the level. They're getting literally like they're handheld. You got to let the artist do their thing. Like, give them a direction so that they know where they're going, but you can't like, you can't leave them with nothing, but you also can't like, yeah, you can't force them to do something that they're not really gonna do, or like that they're like, that they aren't creatively like
inclined to do.
Yeah, exactly. Like, or like not even inclined to do. I think like sometimes pushing people to like experiment is necessary and is like something that makes you grow as an artist, but I mean more in the sense that like if they're feeling the beat and want to do this a certain way, then I don't know, there's just kind of got to be a mutual like understanding between the artist and the producer. Like, you both get what you're doing. It's like, if you hear something that they don't hear and they hear something that you don't hear, you kind of got to trust each other and just kind of like just do it.
This man Pablo unapologetically like no remorsefully meanly all negative wordsly went in on this album. This man went crazy on this album, and I'm excited for everybody to hear, like, just like Pablo right and
here.
Ours.
We got some right here.
I totally forgot y'all had. Oh, I totally forgot.
Let's play some. All right, we got.
You play that? Okay. Should we give like a little context to the song, or should we say ahead. That? After?
So all basically, right. This song is just it's our proposal. You know, like all this right. is like our wedding.
Of
this
course.
This is showing that me and Pablo are in this forever.
Yeah, I'm gonna let the song speak for itself mostly, because I don't want to like over explain it. Like, people can take it how it is, but like it's pretty straightforward from the lyrics. It's just called Icarus, and just kind of like, you know, gonna be with me and make sure that I don't like fall when I'm like at the top, or who's gonna like actually support me, who's like real, you know what I mean? Who's just kind of like, that's how I take it. But
this is a song that's gonna play at me and Pablo's wedding, so
you know. All right, let's hear it. We got Icarus by Unholy Blessings featuring Lucas Lex. Let's go.
Yes, sir.
Shout out Lucas Lex. Thank you for the feature, bro.
Yeah, don't bottleize, you realize we the mother guys. Real nigga, my daddy plies. Real nigga, day in the sky. Daddy clips where I lay my eyes. I ain't scared a lot, we gonna ride. No hate in mine, no hate in mine. Love the camfo. I got people I will kill for. Why they flexing about the hills for? Why endorse all the pills for? Niggas claiming they real. Show me them bills, show me that watch. Show me what you gonna do for your block. Show me what you gonna do when you hot. Boy, it better not get tossed. Boy, like all the hoes that done drop. Boy,
I'm on a mission. I'm heading out straight to the sun. If they don't listen, y'all already know I got my ones with tunnel vision. I'm flying out straight to the sun. We going up. Oh, I'll go the distance. My running eyes don't give no fucks. This must be fishing. Comments and talking too much. Got all ambitions. But you watch my wings near the sun. Let's get those millions.
Frame, all of y'all crop, all of y'all stop. We don't do knots, I'm through with thoughts. They want my quota, need a piece, so I stopped the roller. Face to face, no Motorola. Too much on my plate, give two fucks what your boy say. Got two fists and a fucking face, nigga. Serving good on your block. Down to earth, bedrock. Too dirty, can't rock. Fuck the arms and the clock. We finished stream, fuck the mop. We is what your boy's not. We is what your boy's not, what your boy's not.
down straight to the sun if they don't listen. Y'all already know I got my ones with tunnel vision. I'm flying us straight to the sun, we going up. Oh, I'll go the distance. My rudder dies, don't give no fucks, this must be fishing. Comments and talking too much, got our ambitions. But you watch my wings near the sun, let's get those millions. Whoa, I've been slowly cutting ties, gotta save my life. Gotta save your own self. Now you turn to someone else. Maybe you were just like that. All along I didn't catch that. All along I couldn't see shit. Go to now I can't believe it. Narcissist coming through. And who the fuck are you? And who the fuck are your homies? Ride your dick like a pony. Maybe you were just like that. All along I didn't catch that. All along I couldn't see shit. Go to now I can't believe it. I'm heading out straight to the sun if they don't listen. Y'all already know I got my ones with tunnel vision. I'm flying out straight to the sun, we going up. Oh, I'll go the distance. My rider dies, don't give no fucks, this must be fishing. Comments and talking too much, caught our ambitions. But you watch my wings near the sun, let's get those millions. Whoa.
Yeah, I'm crying right now. Pablo, you didn't even text me back, bro. I sent you a picture of me crying to that song, dog. That was beautiful.
Have you not heard the final master?
I'm not trying to spoil myself, man. I'm trying to hear this thing in order.
You heard it.
Yeah.
All I listened to was the demos.
But y'all,
right, I'm not going to lie. I listen to Sunbeam. Listen to Sunbeam. They'll figure out what Sunbeam is, but I listen to Sunbeam. Sunbeam's about. I'm not ready.
Yeah, thank you for letting us play this exclusive. Right,
thank
here.
You so no much for giving us.
You weren't radio
platform. Yeah, it's so, just like
it feels surreal.
Yeah, no, it's sick as fuck that you guys are doing this, because like this is without you allowing us to do this, like we can't. It just allows us to communicate with our audience a bit more and just kind of like say what we're about. Because
yeah, that's exactly,
you know,
what
like,
I wanted
we can only
to
say too much to the music. Yeah.
Yeah, we so wanted people to know a little bit more about what you guys are about and the background, so they can appreciate the music even more. And we got an amazing track for them to hear. So yeah.
There you go.
Awesome. Yeah, I think this is good. This is a good place to close it. So thank you so much, Unholy Blessings, for being our guests on
Eat Worms Radio. Eat Worms Radio.
July 16th.
Amen. Shout out Eat Worm. Shout out Pablo. Shout out Sean Kim. Shout out Lucas Lex.
Yeah.
Shout out
Jabari.
New album. Yeah.
Shout out Canada.
Y'all not ready. Coming soon.
This single coming out July 17th, not 16th. My bad.
Amen. We got something on the way. We got something on the way. They're not ready for it.
Hey.
Oh, I forgot to leave the call. Hold on.
We gotta keep that part. Thank you for listening to Eat Worms Radio.